Well, good morning. See a lot of new faces here today, a lot of visitors, I guess. We're glad you're here. Welcome. We're going to turn to our call to worship this morning, and it is Psalm 90, verses 1 and 2, and then verses 12. Lord, through all the generations, you have been our home. Before the mountains were created, before you made the earth and the world, you are God, without beginning or end. So teach us to make the most of our time so that we may grow in wisdom. Father, we praise you and thank you for who you are, creator of heaven and earth, our eternal God. You are our home where we can find refuge, rest, and peace. Father, you are, remind us that you are, that our time is short here and that we should use our time wisely. For your glory. Lord, bless this time. Help the worship team lead us in praise and to honor you, and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Blind, but now I seated. And just for a moment before Tom Edmonds comes to lead us in prayer, as the music continues to focus your needs, your petitions on God, He hears your prayers this morning. One of the most important things I believe that we do in this room, if not the most important, is to open our hearts to the presence of God and invite Him to meet our needs. So pray about your needs, focus on Him, bring your hearts into that alignment with His Spirit, and then Tom Edmonds will lead us in our prayer time in just a moment. Let's prepare our hearts for prayer.
The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. The world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Let's pray together. O Lord, in an age when mankind believes that they are the makers of their own destiny and have little use for a God of creation, help us, your children, to proclaim that the earth and everything in it belongs to you. For you created it and will one day redeem it and restore it to its former glory. And for this we thank and praise you, and we look forward to that day when justice and righteousness will be mediated by you, a day when all of creation will bow down before you and declare that you alone are Lord. We admit this morning that we have not been the best stewards of the creation which you gave us to enjoy and manage. We have often maimed and destroyed your creation for our own benefit. We ask your forgiveness. Please help us to see and admire the beauty that remains so that we might preserve and protect it and so carry out your mandate to care for that which you have graciously given to us. For other sins of commission and omission, we ask for your forgiveness and pardon. For those who are sick and unable to be in our fellowship this morning, we pray for your healing presence to be with them at home or in care or in the hospital. For those who are among us this morning and are in need of a touch in their body, we ask you to heal and restore them to health. For those who have lost loved ones recently, we ask you to comfort and console them. And this morning we remember Michael Martinez in Iraq, serving our country in that faraway place and in much danger. Not only for Michael, but for all those who serve with him. Lord, we pray for your protection this morning, that you would be with them and that they would know that there is a God in heaven who loves them and cares for them. As your church, we pray for your guidance as we strive to become the church that you desire. Where there are areas for improvement, help us to see and recognize them, and then with your help, make the necessary changes which bring glory to you. More than anything, we pray for a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit. Revive us again and help us to live and serve you better than ever before. Thank you, Lord, for your Spirit. Be glorified now in the remainder of this service. Open our hearts and minds to your word. Bless our pastor as he brings us the word this morning. And as we dedicate this young life to you this morning, remind all of us of the responsibility we have to ensure that this child will be raised in the love and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. All of these things we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with me as we make our confession of faith together, engaging your hearts and mind in this which we declare that gives us hope in eternal life. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, in Christ's universal church, the communion of all believers, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen? Raise your voice in song. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise
and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Good morning. Are you glad you're in worship? Are you worshiping? I hope that you are. Turn to a couple of people and thank them for worshiping here at Faith Discovery this morning. Make sure you find someone to shake their hand and greet them with the love of Jesus. Amen. All right. Nice to see you back. Good morning. Love baby dedications. Welcome family. I mean, this whole middle here. Church, you could take a lesson from them. Look, they're sitting in the middle. Wonderful seats. Wonderful seats. It's a big building. You can move right in and sit here and I can see you. But it's our privilege to present a little one to the Lord this morning here at Faith Discovery. Before I invite Jamie and Victor to bring little Jordan, they've prepared a short video slide of his life. We prayed for him extensively. He was born very premature on the 17th of March in 2019. And what a joy this morning to present him in dedication to the Lord. But before they come, watch this.
Jordan, you awake? You hear Mommy? Hi, baby. Hi, baby Jordan. Smile. Oh, I love you so much. Smiling. Oh, you look laughing.
Crying out from the pit of my despair. There you were. Shadows holding out your hand, you made me there. And now, where would I be without you? Where would I be, Jesus? You were the voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night. Oh,
Oh. Wow. You'd have to be a sort of half-dead not to let that touch your heart, huh? Ooh, thank you, Lord. Jamie and Victor, would you come this morning and bring your little man, Jordan? Accompanying them today are Steve DeVere and Heather and Nima. Come right up here. Come up here. Jamie, come up here. There we go. You could come up, bud. That's all right. We don't mind. We'll dedicate you, too.
All right.
Stand over here by your dad. No, you stay here. Come on up, group. Hey there, handsome. How are you? You good? Are you going to cry? Make me look good. Come on. Okay, that's a good guy. He won't cry. He doesn't cry. He's a happy guy. He must be an anema. They seem to be about some of the happiest people I've ever met in my life. So, all right, yeah, check that out. I got to look at these people every Sunday. There's only one sad thing, son. I got to get you helped. I saw that Eagles hat on you. That's not good. The purpose of child dedication is to be found in the purpose of parents, actually. We call it a child dedication, but it really is more of a parent's dedication, and we join them in entrusting this little one to Christ as we pledge ourselves to creating a place where this child can be brought up in the training and the instruction of the Lord. Let's hear the word of the Lord as it comes to us from Deuteronomy, the 6th chapter, which says this: "These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, and when you walk along the road, and when you lie down, and when you get up." Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. The passage urges us to live out our life, not leaving it to the church or making it a Sunday-only issue, but our faith is to be integrated into our love for the Lord, and our love for the Lord is to be integrated into the rest of the week, so as to raise our children to understand their own need of Christ as Savior and the importance of that choice to serve Him. We see godly people in the Bible bringing their children to the Lord. Samuel was given to the Lord by Hannah. Jesus was taken to the temple by Joseph and Mary. And following their offering, and there they offered thanks and sacrifice. And Paul reminded Timothy, from infancy he had known the Holy Scriptures. Jesus considered children to be most precious and said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for such is the kingdom of heaven." So I give you this charge this morning. If you would answer when I prompt you, I do. We do. Victor and Jamie, is it your intention as parents to present your child to the Lord today and to pledge yourselves to bring him up in the training and instruction of the Lord? If so, answer, we do.
We do.
Do you recognize this child as a gift of God? I think this is self-evident. And give heartfelt thanks to God for him? If so, answer, we do.
We do.
Do you hear that this day dedicate your child to the Lord who gave him to you? If so, answer, we do.
We do.
Do you accept your holy responsibility to teach Jordan to love and obey the Lord insofar as it is possible for you to influence his decision in life to follow Christ as Savior? If so, answer, we do.
We do.
Congregation, I charge you, if you would stand this morning, will you join me and this family in loving Jordan for the sake of the kingdom of God? If so, answer, we do.
We do.
All right. Hey, pal. I love all baby dedications, but this one is particularly special. Jordan, it's my privilege to anoint you in the name of God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit and get your preacherly hands off my head. Pray with me. Father, we love you. We thank you for the gift of Jordan's life. We thank you for the miracles, Lord, that brought him to us. We thank you for being all of our rescue story. Lord, we ask that you would bless this family with wisdom and stamina and help them to remain faithful to the commitment and promises that they have made before you.
I pray, Lord Jesus, that you would keep Faith Discovery as a church in your care, that we can fulfill our responsibility to pray for this child and to partner with his parents, to provide a place where he can grow and understand the life that he is called to in you. We ask this all in the name of the one who said, "Allow the little children to come to me," Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. And God's people said, amen. You may be seated. God bless you. Thank you, sir. There you go. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm.
Well, good morning again. What a wonderful thing to have right in the middle of our service. So congratulations, and we are glad to have all of you extended family with us today. And thank you for all of you for being here to worship together. If you haven't filled out your who's who in the pew, you can fill that out. Pastor Jerry always appreciates if you have prayer requests to write them on the back. He will pray about them throughout the week. Awana Clubs, we are meeting today at 4 o'clock. Today is crazy hair or crazy hat night. So all of you kids, all of you leaders, I know the leaders are very excited about wearing their crazy hair. We'll be seeing you at 4 o'clock, and youth as well, meeting up in the Family Fellowship Center. I don't think you have to do anything crazy, just show up. All right, Wednesday Fellowship is continuing. They are done with the book of Romans and moving on to the letter to the Hebrews. So we are starting brand new. It's a wonderful time to join that group on Wednesday evenings at 7 o'clock right in the cafe. You are more than welcome to join that group led by Pastor Jerry. And it's almost time for our women's group to meet again. We meet once a month on the fourth Friday of the month, which is coming up next week. So you are invited to join us as well, Friday evening at 7 o'clock, also in the cafe. We're going through a book, but even if you don't have that book and you just like to come, it's a video series as well. We would love to see you there on the 28th. And today is the last day for our survey. The leadership team did not develop a survey just for wasting paper. Us as a leadership team, we value your input. We would love to know how we can serve you better, how we can serve each other better, and most importantly, how all of us collectively can serve the name of Jesus together. So if you could take 5-10 minutes at the end of service, grab a, what are they called? Survey. Grab a survey in the cafe and stick it right in the box. We would love to have your input. Whether you've been here for 2 weeks or for 20 years, all of it is valuable to us. All right, we are going to dismiss the children up to Children's Church. Thank you to our leaders who so faithfully serve in that ministry every week, and ask our ushers to come forward, please. Dear Lord, we have been so wonderfully reminded about your faithfulness this morning, Lord, and we pray that as we remember that throughout the week, throughout our lives, Lord, that you would help us to know what you have given to us comes straight through your hands. We pray that we would take those things and give a portion back joyfully, and that you would use it for your work here in this community and beyond. And we pray these things in your Son's name.
I was thinking about the dedication of little Jordan earlier this week, and this song, this is an older chorus of praise, came to mind, and I sang it in the middle of the night, giving thanks to the little guy. As you grab the words and melody, join me.
Bless God for all that he's done. Bless God for Christ his Son.
Is this microphone working? Yes, there it goes. I see the light blinking. You may have to switch me to this mic if the battery goes dead. And a good morning. We are working our way through a series of messages on spiritual disciplines. Wow. How you doing with those spiritual disciplines? Not so great? So great? Good? Not so good? Depends on the day. I appreciate your honesty. Yes, it does depend on the day. Hold on just a second. I just spilled sacred anointing oil on the pulpit. There's more than one way to get the anointing, I guess. Okay. There we go. All right. So, we have been talking about this, and I have spoken with you about the freedom to live in the disciplines, the freedom that the disciplines bring to us. I talked to you about meditation, contemplative prayer. I talked about petitionary prayer. I talked about study. Last week, I brought you a message on simplicity. And this week, building on that theme of simplicity, in a sense, I would like to talk to you about stewardship. Stewardship. Who doesn't love, I know I do, who doesn't love seeing a building, a business, a building, a church, or personal life that shows that someone is really engaged with excellence? You like that, right? I like that. I'm taken by that. I want to illustrate it from something that probably not most of us. How many of you enjoy car shopping? I guess I'm alone in the room. Yeah, a couple of us. I enjoy buying cars. You want a car? Just get me. I'll get you a good deal. I really enjoy buying cars. And I was notorious in this church until recently when I started to think about retiring. My car just got 3 years old, and it was like time to trade it. And I said, no, you're going to have a limited income soon. You got to keep the car. I was notorious, though, every 2 years. Right, church? New car in the parking lot? How many of you remember that? What color was it usually?
Red.
Red, yeah. So I can tell you, I have a lot of experience with car dealers. And I would go into a dealership, and there would be this quick evaluation that I would do. Is this place well managed? Are they going to service this product that they sell me, or is this not so together? And sometimes you go in and there's a salesman that engages, or a salesperson that engages you within a couple of moments of stepping through the door, and they show you that they've got the product mastered, and you say, oh, I like this place. Or you go into a place and nobody talks to you, and you wander around like a lost dog, and you look at cars, nobody says anything to you, and then you just leave. You say, whoa, nobody's managing this place. Anybody understand what I'm talking about? Yeah. My last car that I bought, I won't tell you the dealership, it's over in Easton. I was amazed. I walked into this place in 2017, and it wasn't the fanciest showroom. In fact, it looked a lot like a warehouse. Walked into the place, was not in the building 30 seconds before someone came up, introduced themselves, handed me a card, and said, anything I can do to help you, sir? I said, well, I think I'm looking for this, this, this. These are the things that I want. Within a moment or two, he says, I think I've got some products that can serve your need. Let me walk you out through the lot, show you the, showed me three or four or five, I don't remember, cars. And 2 hours later, I drove away in a new car. That's a well-managed dealership, right? Yeah, you can identify. So whether we're talking about a business, whether we're talking about a church, whether we're talking about a flower garden, there is an importance to be involved in managing life well. It's an evidence that somebody really, really cares. Because the natural thing of life is to devolve into disorder. You understand that too, right? How many people have ever planted a flower garden? How many people have forgotten about that flower garden for 3 months? And what do you have then? A weed garden. Yes. It takes absolutely no effort to grow a weed garden, right? But it takes a lot of effort to grow a beautiful flower garden because things devolve. We know that about our personal health, right? How many of you, you know, were born an athlete in tremendous shape, and right on through to this point in your life, you've stayed fit and trim and your muscles are in great shape and you did absolutely nothing but eat hot dogs and McDonald's? No, it didn't happen that way, right? How did you stay in shape? You worked at it. You ate the right things. You got the right exercise. You got the right rest. You took care of that body, because otherwise, you know, it devolves. It doesn't evolve. It devolves into disorder and decay. And so it is as we talk about spiritual maturity. No one becomes an established, fruitful, effective disciple of Jesus Christ simply by accident, or even because you wish it to be true. It takes
spiritual discipline, the discipline of stewardship. Now, a lot of times when we talk about stewardship, you're thinking I'm going to talk about money. Not today. I'm not going to talk about money. So everybody take a deep breath. Put your pocketbook and your wallet away and your checkbook away. We're not going to talk about money this morning. That's next week. Please come. Don't stay home next week. Okay. But we're going to talk about stewardship today of life itself. It's from the very beginning, the Bible makes clear, Doc talked about it in his prayer, that we are stewards. We are called to take care of those things that God has given to us. Addressing Adam and Eve, God said this, often misunderstood, but actually a very, very good text. God said, be fruitful and increase in number. That humanity is done. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over it. It doesn't mean in the sense of exploiting, but managing well, being responsible for. Rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and over every living creature that moves on the ground. In so many words, God says, here's the earth, you take care of it. Here's creation, you take care of it. Maybe you don't understand the word stewardship, or it's not a word you use all the time. A steward is simply a manager, an agent, or one that's in charge of a matter. And stewardship, therefore, follows is someone who is acting, is the act of being responsible for the things that are entrusted to us. I sometimes love to study words, and this is an interesting word. The word steward comes to us in modern English from an old English word, the stiward, the guy who was in charge of the pigsty. Don't you love that? Yeah, and also the cattle pens. When they lived in an agricultural society, when your very existence depended on keeping your livestock healthy and keeping anyone from stealing them, it was incredibly important to have someone who was ultra responsible as the steward, as the one who was taking care of the livestock. And how did you get to be the steward? Well, you had to exercise, you had to earn that, you had to be responsible. So you're a steward. I want to ask you this morning this question. How do you tend the resources God has entrusted to you? Is your life full of incomplete projects, unmet obligations, unpaid bills, broken relationships, and unfinished business? Or have you learned with God's help and by the power of the Holy Spirit to live a life that has order, a sense of rhyme and reason, a life that is making measurable progress and growth from day to day and month to month and year to year? And some of you may be thinking, how does that matter spiritually? Does God really care about unfinished projects and unbalanced checkbooks and chaotic lives? Well, I believe that he does. Judge for yourself from the words from St. Paul. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul writes, by the grace that God has given me, I lay the foundation as an expert builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should be careful how he builds, for no one could lay any foundation other than one already laid, which is Christ Jesus. If any man builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple, that God's Spirit lives in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is sacred, and you are that temple. And then in the fourth chapter, these words. So then, men, people, ought to regard us as servants of Christ and as those entrusted with the secret things of God, God's stewards. And now it is required of those who have been given a trust that they must prove faithful. I hope that passage sobers you. Christians whose lives are best lived live their life in the light of eternity, knowing that ultimately every one of us will stand before Jesus Christ. Now, let's back up and be clear about an important fact here.
When the Bible talks about the believer's judgment, he's not talking about whether you have eternal life or whether you make it into heaven. I'm so thankful for that. That's one reason I don't fear death. Oh, I fear dying, but I don't fear death, because my eternal destiny is not at all the result of my good performance or my discipline or my spiritual work. I'm certainly thankful for that. My spiritual destiny is a gift of God. Amen? I receive that through Jesus Christ. That is an imparted gift to me, and therefore I can be completely confident that I will stand in the presence of God. But Paul says this: every believer will stand before God and give an account of the way that he or she has used his life. It is required of stewards, those who have a trust, that they be found faithful. Remember the imagery he used in that passage. He said that there are temporary building materials, wood, hay, and straw, and there's permanent, gold, silver, and precious stones. And what's the test? Fire. So some of us, to push the metaphor, are going to get into heaven, and we're going to smell like smoke. Everything we did is going to go poof, gone in the fiery gaze of Jesus, and we are going to enter into heaven naked as a jaybird, so to speak. No glory, no reward, because everything we have done has either been for self or has been purposed, not without eternal purpose. But our salvation intact, but our rewards depend on us taking care of that temple where God is worshipped. And he said, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. The things that you do, the way that you live, the words that you say, the relationships you have, they are building God's honor in that temple which is you, that temple which is me. So now I hope you understand the importance of stewardship. There are a lot of ways, as I said before, we can look at stewardship. This morning, as I finish up, I want to talk about time. Stewardship of our time. All right, there we go. Let me talk about three principles. The spiritual discipline of stewardship of our time requires, as I've already mentioned, that you live, first of all, with the finish line in your sights. That you understand that it is eternity's light that makes your vision clear. I just ask the question and leave it hanging out there. How often do you consciously bring to mind that eternity is out there? It will affect how you live your life. It will affect how you run your race. 20 plus years ago, one of my daughters, Maribel, was attending prep school in New England, and Maribel, even though she's only, I don't know, 5'3" maybe, can run like the wind. I loved going to her meets and watching her run, and she was so fast that she became the entire New England prep school's 200-meter champion that year and brought home a really nice trophy. But I learned something about running that I had never known. I guess I should have known it, but it became obvious as I would go to the track meets and spend all day and watch the various schools in competition. Do you know that there's a huge difference in the way that a sprinter runs a race and a long-distance runner runs a race? Yeah. They both have the finish line in sight. They're both aimed at finishing the race. But if you're a distance runner and you explode out of the starting blocks like Maribel with a giant burst of energy like she would use in a sprint, what would happen before you had gone a quarter mile? You would be exhausted. You can't maintain that pace. So those who were running distance, they set their sights in the finish line, but they measured the expenditure of their energy. The sprinters, on the other hand, they gave it everything they had. They only had, what'd they run, 100 meters and something less than, or right around 10 seconds. I don't exactly remember, but I think it's about that. They would just explode, bam, down the track, and the race would be over before you could blink. There are going to be times in your life when you are serving Christ and that finish line is in sight, when you're going to have to pour everything you have into it. You're going to have to try to sprint to get to a certain place. But most of the time, our life in Christ, the way that we steward our life, will be with a measured, balanced expenditure of our energies toward God, pushing on. Paul uses this phrase, I press on. I love that phrase. The Bible encourages us to learn as we keep the finish line in sight. Hebrews chapter 12 says, "So fix your eyes on Jesus, who is both the author, the beginner, and the perfecter, the completer of your faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorned its shame, and then finally sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him so you will not grow weary and lose heart." Keep the finish line in sight. Some of you may be reacting to that and saying, well, that's really grim, Pastor. Not if heaven is your hope. Not if Christ is your Savior. You say, well, who wants to die? Well, we're not in any hurry. But if heaven is our home, we have an assurance. We know that we're going home. We know that we're going to step into our eternal reward. We know that there is a life prepared for us by which the glory of which makes this life pale by comparison. Amen? Thank you that three of you believe that. All right. Live with the finish line in sight. Number two, it seems almost contradictory. Live fully engaged in the present. Hang with me. There are so many people who miss out on the opportunities that God is giving them today because they're either longing for yesterday or waiting on tomorrow. Paul was inspired by the Spirit to give this directive in Ephesians 5. He says, "Be very careful how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is." Millions of people live in a realm of fantasy and dreams that are totally disconnected from the world in which they live. Their days pass with attention on a little screen, taken up in fake lives portrayed on television, pursuing things that have some importance but certainly not much eternal importance. And day after day after day after day after day goes by with those same people living almost on autopilot. And if you were to say to them at the end of the week, "How was your week?" "I don't know. Another day, another dollar." "What did you do meaningfully this week?" "What do you mean meaningfully? I don't even know what that means. I just survived." What a tragedy. What a tragedy. God has a preparation of each day for you and me, opportunities for each day. That doesn't mean that there isn't routine. Of course there is. That doesn't mean that we won't occasionally find ourselves, you know, just doing the same thing because it's what we do. Of course we will. Novelty is not what I'm talking about. But we have to move ourselves out of dreaming about another place, another circumstance, another time past or another time that may come, and live in the day that God has given to us. Because every day we spend longing for yesterday or wishing for tomorrow is a day lost. Yes. Please don't adopt Annie's theme song as, you know, the theme song of your life. "Tomorrow, tomorrow, I love you tomorrow, you're only a day away." Tomorrow may never come. Equally true, yesterday's gone. You know my story. 4 years ago, four and a half almost now, well, four, my wife passed away. Something I never anticipated happening. There were probably some mistakes that I made following her death, but one of the mistakes that I did not want to make and I refused to make was to spend the rest of my days on this earth looking back and wishing for life with her. I loved her dearly, and we had a great 41 years, but guess what? That chapter is over. That part of the book is closed. Life is not better or worse. Life is different. And that's what I told myself 1,000 times. Life is now different. It's not over, it's different. And to remind myself, I tattooed Ephesians 3 on this arm that says, "There is immeasurably more to come in the grace of God." Immeasurably more. I don't know what you've been through. I don't know if you've had a tremendous success and you feel like you've peaked and you're past it, or if you had a terrible, terrible disappointment and you feel like you never can recover. But the fact is, God says, today I have opportunities for you. Will you live in them? Will you find the present that I have and live in it, making the most of every opportunity? Paul says it this way, Philippians 3, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward. Every morning without fail, the first thing I do when my eyes open, I lift my hands openward toward heaven and I say, God, it's your day, not mine. What are we going to do with it? What are we going to do with it? I don't always do it well, but I recognize from the get-go of every new day, this is his day. He's got opportunities. Lord, give me the eyes to see them. Live fully engaged in the present. Principle number two. Number three, know this. Life has seasons. Ecclesiastes chapter 3. You're familiar with it? It says, to everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to uproot, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to tear down, a time to build, a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, a time to dance, a time to be silent, a time to speak, a time to love, a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. We all go through seasons in life. We enter into those seasons in which there's winter. Winter is a season, at least for me, that in the cold and the dormant time, it's a time to endure and to take hold of hope. Every one of us are going to experience winters. Those 20 months between Bev's diagnosis and her death were a long winter. There were beautiful moments, but there was the knowledge that she would be leaving. And it was a winter season, and I had to live in that winter season. And I had to understand that faith could sustain us, that faith could be with us. So you're going to enter winters. Maybe you're in a winter spiritually. When you worship, there's just no warmth in your soul. When you pray, it seems like your prayers bounce off the ceiling. When you open the scripture, you read words, but they say nothing to you. That's a winter season. We all go through those times spiritually. Know the season. Respond to the season properly. When winter is here, you don't live as if it's summer. You understand that it's winter. You dress differently, engage in different different activities. It's the way we respond. What's the season of your life? There are spring seasons. I love the springtime. It's the time to plant. It's the time when everything begins new. And when it's time when just the earth burgeons again here in the north with green and with growth. But we as individuals experience springtimes. For whatever reason, in the purposes of God, we have moments not necessarily related to our chronological age when life just takes on something new. New love, new calling, new passion, new discoveries of God's grace, new understandings of His Word. When God is moving in our lives, and I love those springtimes. But we have to understand that as glorious as it is, spring too is a passing season, and soon it will be summer. And summers are great, but they're different. Summers bring to us a time often to be playing, to be refreshed, to be waiting in a season, because summer is a season when, especially in an agricultural society, when there is the waiting for the harvest that will come. Maybe you're in a summertime, and that's also a pretty good season. It's a season when everything, you're doing those things that are preparing yourself for the harvest that will come. And then there certainly is the autumn or the fall, which is harvest in preparation again for the winter that will follow. When we finish tasks, when we come to some point in life where we're able to reap the goodness that God has given to us. I'm sort of feeling as a parent that I'm in an autumn season. My oldest son this week, Monday, was 43 years old. Can you believe I have a 43-year-old kid? Don't answer that. But but it's kind of wonderful to see him
with his business and his life established and his personal relationships good and his son's doing well. And I'm enjoying that with each one of my four children, watching them grow, watching them develop in their marriages, in their lives as parents, with their jobs. Oh, do they do things I don't like? Oh, of course they do, but they don't let me live their life, obviously. But it's a wonderful season in my life to sort of relax and say, I'm not responsible for them anymore, but I can enjoy the fruit of what I've seen in their life. I can enjoy the realization of the training. And they're now old enough, you know, they lived long enough that they actually say to me, thank you, Dad, for doing those things we used to hate you for. That's a really cool autumn reward, you know. You know, say, oh, Dad, you know, we realize now that you did that for a purpose. My two sons especially thank me for the stewardship lessons that I gave them as they were growing up, when I wouldn't provide things for them that they wanted. And they're, Dad, why are you so cheap? I'm not cheap. I'm trying to teach you the value of a dollar. Dad, why won't you? Well, because you need to understand. And now they do understand, and they're both successful businessmen. In large part, they say, because they had training and understanding these things in their life. I don't know what the season is in your life, but seasons of autumn are wonderful because they allow you to reap the harvest of the things that you have planted. Stewardship. What a discipline. What a wonderful discipline. I ask you this morning again, if you're praying that you will be led by the Spirit every day to make the choices that will let you live well. No, not using the American success dream as your standard, but a life that is filled with the fruit of the Holy Spirit and that is effective for the purposes of God. A life that is focused on eternity, that anticipates the reward. A life that has the finish line in sight. A life that understands that today has unique opportunities, and if they're not used, they're not taken, they'll be gone, probably never to return again. A life that does have seasons. And so we follow that rhythm. Not resisting it, but understanding each season has its unique blessing and its unique challenges as we move through those seasons of our lives. If we do this, the Bible says that we will be overflowing with the life of the Holy Spirit. As we get ready to close the service, I want to challenge you with this. The very first stewardship decision that every one of us must make with our life is to ask ourselves, who is in charge of me? Who is my hope? Not what, but who? Is my life ego-driven? Is my life about me? My life about self-fulfillment? Or will I surrender my life to Christ as Lord and Savior, inviting Him to be in charge of me, in charge of my days, in charge of that building of the temples that Paul talked about? That's the first stewardship choice. If God's speaking to your heart this morning, I hope that you'll make that choice. You'll say, Christ Jesus, be Lord of my life. Speak to me. Would you bow your heads with me? Father, we love you and thank you for your call, for your word, for the truth. As we engage ourselves, Lord, in the discipline of stewardship, I pray that you would give us wisdom to make the most of every opportunity so that someday, when we stand before you, we will be able to hear those words that I so desire for myself and for every person in this congregation. Well done, good and faithful servant. Speak to our hearts, Lord. As we leave this place, help us not to forget you nor to forget your presence, but to live for you, I pray in Christ's name. And God's people said, stand with me and sing one more time that song that I played just before I preached. Bless God for all he's done.
Bless God. One voice of praise to thee.
Receive the good word as you go, and may it bless your hearts. May the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation that you might know him better. And I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you might know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. Now be kept in his love, living with joy. Go in peace. God bless. Amen.